Welcome to another episode of Mr. Carlson's Lab. In this video, we're going to talk about the validity of a signal tracer on your test bench. So this little signal tracer here is an RF or radio frequency and audio frequency AF style signal tracer. So what we're going to do is take this thing apart, repair this thing. I'll talk about the circuitry. We'll take a look at the schematic so that you get a good feel of what this thing is and how it works. And then once it's repaired, we'll talk about how to signal trace and troubleshoot with this device. So really, if you're into repairing radios or stereos or audio amplifiers or TVs or anything like that, this thing really is your friend. In fact, I have a couple of these things and I do use them quite often. So let's get into the video and start repairing this thing. Here's an overview of the controls on the front side of this Heathkit signal tracer. So first of all, what a signal tracer is really is nothing more than a very high gain audio amplifier with a few extra perks. So if you were to look at the gain control here as a volume control or a master, you could plug a microphone into the audio jack here and use this thing as a small public address system. Now when I say small, I mean small. There's not a very big audio transformer or audio stage in here, but you get the idea. So we'll start here at the top with the speaker switch. It's pretty self-explanatory, off and on. Just allows you to turn the speaker in the unit on or off. Now this is quite handy if you're going to be troubleshooting stages where you're, say, going to encounter an unexpected large signal. So what you would do is you turn the speaker off and you just use the visual indicator on the bottom here, or as they call it, a level meter, and you just watch for the deflection on the eye tube here. Alright, so just say, you know, if you're troubleshooting a very low gain stage and you're getting a little bit of deflection there, and then all of a sudden the eye completely closes, you would know that you've come across, you know, a high level signal of some sort. And if you had the speaker on at that point, it might be very loud. So kind of a handy switch there. This high gain switch, all this does is ground out the grid of the tube that is connected to this RF jack, and I'll explain that when we start looking at the schematic here in just a little bit. It's kind of hard to explain without this thing open. So the gain control, really, again, is just a volume control, and that affects the gain of both of these jacks here. Here we have tracer mode, noise mode, and watt meter mode. So tracer, we're just using this thing as a standard signal tracer. Now, noise mode is a very interesting function. It puts some high voltage onto the tip of the tracing probe. So if you're going to be using this in solid state electronics, that would be very, very bad news. But if you're, say, troubleshooting old radios or vacuum tube amplifiers or something like that, and you had, say, a crackly mica capacitor, or, you know, there was a resistor that was starting to get crackly or staticky, this allows you to put high voltage across that component and see if that component is actually making the crackling. Kind of a very neat feature. So there's 160 plus volts on the tip of this, you know, of this jack here. So you got to be very careful when you're using these things because there's high voltage everywhere. Even on these jacks here, there's full B plus or full high voltage on these jacks right here, and you could get very badly shocked. And it's exposed right here. If you were to just reach around like this, you would get an extremely bad shock. So you need to know what you're doing when you're using one of these things. And if you ever get one of these, I strongly suggest you read the manual and look over it. And of course, if you're following along, you're doing so at your own risk. Just take care. You need to know the high voltage precautions here. High voltage on the tip of this in noise mode, and across these jacks here, there's high voltage. So you want to be very, very careful. And if somebody has wired this wrong, these things are kits, there could be high voltage anywhere on here. So you got to be very, very careful. When this is in watt meter mode, it allows you to use this control here to see how many watts a device that you've plugged into this outlet here is drawing. So you use the meter here, this little level meter, or the deflection of the eye tube here, to tell you how many watts something is drawing. So we'll look at this here and I'll show you exactly how this works once we've got this thing all repaired. These jacks here that have high voltage on them all the time are for testing output transformers, and you can hook a speaker voice coil across this as well to test the speaker voice coil. And that's pretty much how the controls on the front side of this Heathkit signal tracer works. So next, let's go inside this thing, open it up, and see how it's put together. In order to get inside this thing, it's really quite simple. Just two screws on the rear here, and this will just come right off. Now, somebody's cut the line cord off of this thing. I guess it was in pretty bad shape. The cord does look like it was cracking and everything. I can see all the cracks there, so somebody probably did that to you know, make this safe so nobody would end up plugging this thing in. So have to end up replacing that cord. So I've already removed this screw here. So what I'll do is I'll remove this one right here. Just like so. And just lift this off. And what I'll do is I'll reposition the camera and we'll take a closer look at what's inside. This is the top side of the chassis in this little Heathkit signal tracer. And Heathkit did a really nice job in laying this thing out. I quite like the layout here. Now, immediately after removing this from the case, I can see what the engineers were thinking when they put this thing together. So the number one thing whenever you're designing any kind of high gain audio amplifier is you want the highest gain stage as far away from the power transformer as possible. And as you can see, they're at opposite ends of the chassis. And no doubt when Heathkit was designing this thing, they probably moved the transformer back and forth on the chassis to see how far they would have to get it away from these tubes in order to stop this from inducing hum over here. So this obviously worked out to be just right at about this size here. We can also see that the audio output transformer is mounted sideways compared to the power transformer, and that's to stop the field of the power transformer from interfering with the audio transformer and directly inducing hum into this, and that hum would be apparent at the speaker. This little transformer here is for the watt meter readings on the front. And you can see this is mounted relatively close to the transformer. Now, this really isn't tied into any of the audio circuitry, so it being this close really isn't such a big deal. And as we can also see, they were thinking the bobbin of the transformer is this way for the power transformer, and the bobbin of the transformer that is used for the watt meter readings is this way. So how this thing works is really quite simple. This is the main power transformer for the whole unit here. So this supplies the heater voltage. The heater voltage lights all the tubes up. And this also supplies the high voltage that's needed for the plates of the amplifier tubes over here. So the high voltage AC is present on the secondary winding here, and it goes to the plates of this rectifier tube here. All right. So these are basically, in modern day view, if you wanted to look at this is just two diodes in one glass case, and it's in a full wave configuration in the circuit here. We'll look at the schematic here quite shortly. So the center tap of the secondary is to the chassis, and both outer ends go to one plate and the other plate there. So one outer end goes to the top plate and the other outer end goes to the bottom plate. The cathode of this tube, which is isolated from the heater, there's no connection between the glowing heater and the cathode. This is an indirectly heated tube. All right, the cathode runs off of this tube and goes over to this filter can here, and this filters the DC so that we get nice clean DC. So this is the main filter capacitor for this chassis here. This tube here is the highest gain stage. So this tube is directly connected to this RF jack here. So the signal, if you wanted very, very high gain, you would put it into here, go through this capacitor here, through the terminal tie strip, and right up into the grid cap of this audio amplifier tube here. Now, when you're looking at the cap on any kind of a vacuum tube, sometimes they're not grid caps, sometimes they're plate caps. And if this is a plate cap, that means that there's high voltage potential on that cap. So you need to know your tubes, or there could be extremely high voltage on this tube. Now, this is a grid cap, which means that this is where the signal comes in. So there really isn't any high voltage present on this particular tube cap at all, unless this, you know, unit has been wired incorrectly or something like that. This little switch here is the high gain switch, and you can see it's in the off position. Now, what that means is, you can see that we have a line to the switch here, and it's just tied directly to the chassis. In the off position, it's connecting these two terminals on the switch here, and that's grounding the grid cap of this tube out. So you can see this wire here runs down to here, and that's directly connected to the yellow wire, which runs up to the grid cap here. This shielding is not connected to the grid cap at all. This is just connected to the chassis to stop any kind of stray hum. There's a length of wire here. Remember, this is a very high gain stage, and even having this exposed cap on the top here, you know, it's quite possible that there could be some induced hum just by having this open like that. So that's what this is for. So this tube here is actually between this jack and this jack here. If you plug your audio signal into this jack here, it bypasses this tube and goes directly into this tube here. And this tube here, it gets amplified, the signal gets amplified here and goes into this tube, which drives this audio output transformer. So this is a 12A6, which is an audio output tube. And again, this is the driver for this power, or the audio output transformer here. So basically what's happening is if you don't want to use this jack on the front here, you want this in the off position so that it keeps the noise from this grid down. So basically you're grounding this grid out. If you're to leave this in the on position and you're to turn the gain up to amplify this here, what's happening is you're also amplifying any kind of hum or stray noise that's going to be picked up by all this open line here. So if you're just using this jack, it's important to have this in the off position. So that's how the tube layout is. Basically, you know, highest gain, second highest gain, audio transformer driver is how this is working here. So kind of in this fashion right here. So the parts that we need to replace in order to make this thing dependable is all the wax capacitors have to go. This main filter can is going to have to go. So I'm probably not going to remove it. I'll just, you know, undo the lugs on the bottom of the can here. I'll leave the can in here. And I'll just put new capacitors on the bottom. I also need to check all the resistors that are present here. Now, if we look at the bottom side of the chassis, we can see there's lots of wax capacitors that have to go here. So all of these wax capacitors all have to be replaced. This is an electrolytic. Looks like somebody's burnt the corner of that with their soldering iron. This electrolytic will have to be replaced. Of course, we need to replace the line cord. And check all the resistors. Now, there's a mixture of Allen Bradley style resistors, the squared off bodies, and there's the roundies here. Now these roundies are horrible for drifting in value. So these are very important to check. So this looks like 2.2 meg and this looks like a 10 meg a resistor here. So I'll have to be checking all of these things to make sure that they're okay. If they're all testing relatively close, I'll leave the roundies in, but if a few of them are off, they'll all just get replaced. The Allen Bradleys are usually pretty good. They don't go too far in value unless they've been really stressed. I have to go in and spray cleaner in the potentiometers and the switches here and just make sure everything's nice and clean. And after I spray the contact cleaner in, I'll put a little bit of synthetic oil right on the main shaft. So I'll remove the knobs on the front here and put a little dab of synthetic oil right where the shaft goes into the potentiometer and the switches here, just to keep them lubricated. And after that's done, we should be pretty much ready to test this. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start replacing these capacitors here, and I'll show you exactly how I go about doing that. I'm ready to start removing the components on the underside of this chassis here. So the first thing I'm going to do is desolder this capacitor. Now I'll probably get rid of the capacitors first, and then as I'm doing this, I'll end up checking the resistors. So I'll just get my desoldering tool in here. Remove that end there. And they come out just like that. So just depending on how the person has built the circuit, sometimes they've wrapped the leads around, sometimes they don't. So some come out a little bit easier than others. Some of these look like they're in here pretty rough, so I'll probably have to use my pliers and move them around. So I vacuum the solder off and then bend the lead around and then pull it out. Now, usually when people build these things, they're in quite a rush. And here again, just like in the Heathkit oscilloscope video, there's an unsoldered terminal on the capacitor here. So there's about three. They've tied three components to this one lug here and put no solder on it. So again, when people get these kits, they're excited to get them up and running and start using them. And of course they rush through everything and sometimes forget to solder things. So this is the first thing I've seen that's not soldered here. I haven't really gone through anything else here. So there may be more at this point. I really don't know. So what I'm going to do is replace the capacitors with the appropriate values. And I'll also go through here and test all the resistors at the same time. Now, I noticed that the person that built this thing put the capacitors in the correct ways. They've put the outside foil into the chassis here, and they've done it pretty much through all of this here. This one's done correctly. This one's done correctly. This one's done correctly down here. There's another one under here that's done correctly. So they've installed most of the capacitors the correct way. So that's one thing to take note of whenever you're doing this, and especially in high gain stages like this, you want to make sure that you definitely follow that. If you're replacing this with a modern capacitor, you definitely want to find the outside foil end or the outside metallized polypropylene layer and put it in circuit the correct way. So what I'll do is I'll keep plugging along here and get rid of some more of these components here and test all the resistors, and I'll be back. I've now completely recapped this signal tracer. That includes the electrolytic capacitors and all the paper capacitors. So they've all been changed out. Also went through and tested all the resistors, and they're all very close to their value. So I figure I'll just leave them in. Of course, the final test will be when we apply power to this thing, right? On the top side of the chassis here, there is the existing filter can. All right, so with these new electrolytic capacitors that I've installed here, I've completely disconnected this can, and I'm using the lugs on the bottom of the can to support ceramic standoffs. Now, the new capacitors are soldered to these ceramic standoffs, so there's absolutely no connection to the old capacitor. The old capacitor basically is just a support structure for everything that's new. Whenever you replace electrolytic capacitors in anything, you can't tie new capacitors to the old one, because almost all the time when the older electrolytic capacitor fails, it fails in a short condition, so you've pretty much defeated what you've done if you've just tacked them across the old capacitor. So that's how these are installed. Now, I've changed the orientation of the way the resistors and everything worked in here. They kind of had it in a horseshoe across the capacitor lugs here. I had to move the resistors around and get creative with some of the existing tie points here so that I could fit the new capacitors in a nice clean fashion. So that's what I've done. So the circuitry is all the same, just things have been moved around to clean things up just a little bit. I've gone through and I've cleaned all the potentiometers on the face here. So there's a potentiometer here and here and a switch, and I've also cleaned this switch and I've lubricated them. All right, I've taken the tubes out here and cleaned them up as well. I don't know whether this tube is in the right position or not when I fire this thing up for the first time. We'll see, and if I have to rotate this to get the shadow angle correct, then I'll do that at that point, or the deflection angle, or whatever you want to call that. So on the face of the unit here, you can see I've changed the two jacks and I've put B and C's in here. Now, I've got lots of BNC connectors, and every probe that I have seems to have a BNC end on it, so I really don't feel like designing probes just especially for this unit. I like to just take what I've got and just clip it on and use it. Of course, I'll have to use some caution with this because, this puts some voltage back out through, some of the probes, or it would put voltage back out if I, had it in the noise mode. All right, in the tracer mode, there is no voltage on the jacks here. And we'll look at that here when I turn this thing on for the first time here. So this thing hasn't been fired up, so we'll see if it works and what happens. I also cleaned these switches here as well, moved them back and forth a little bit and got them moving nice and smooth. On the top here, I think this thing has really low time on it. The reason I think this is, I took the tubes out just to clean them up. These are lots of dust and crud and wipe down the chassis, and these tubes were in these sockets like they were put in for the first time and left. I don't think anything's been touched on this thing. These things were really rough to get out. They're, really carefully move them around. You can't wiggle them too much because you can break the index pin off the bottom of these tubes. So you got to be really careful. You just kind of want to pull straight up and just kind of rock them a little bit and they'll come out of the socket. But boy, these were really tight. So I changed the capacitor back here as well. As you can see, I've installed the new BNCs here. And on this side here, I cleaned up the little glass tube. Also put in another line cord. And so the line cord is out of an old Heathkit as well. And it looks pretty good. So I just cleaned the cord up and no cracks in it or anything like that. And it's nice and soft and pliable still. So that worked out really quite nicely. So I just harvested this cord off of another old Heathkit. I also replaced, they had just a standard paper cap across the line here from the line to the chassis. I replaced that with the appropriate safety capacitor. So that's been installed down there now as well. I also replaced the cathode capacitor here on the 12A6 tube. All right. So the original capacitor is this one right here. It's a 10 microfarad at 25 volts. You can see the size of it. This is the one that has that soldering iron-like burn on it. You can see it's that little hole has opened up there, and it's leaking out of that little hole there. So this is definitely well beyond its date. Of course, all of these things are anyways, but this one here is definitely showing it. So this is the new capacitor right down here. That's the size of it. It's the same value, but double the voltage. How things have changed. Look at the size difference there. So that just kind of fits right nicely in the bottom of the socket here. It doesn't take up a big chunk of the chassis area like the old one did. And that's pretty much what's been done at this point. Doesn't sound like a whole lot, but this actually took a whole bunch of time to do. I think most of it was planning this area out and trying to fit everything in correctly. So quite a bit of time involved in that just alone, just getting the electrolytics in here. So what I'm going to do now is get this thing hooked up to some AC power. I'm going to hook this up to my Variac supply. And it's also an isolation transformer. So I'll get that all hooked up and I'll turn this thing off so that we can start it in the off position. I've been cleaning all the potentiometers, so when you clean them, you spray contact cleaner in them and you move them around a whole lot, and that's why these things are all over the place. So I'll turn that down to zero, have this in tracer mode, I'll have the high gain off and the speaker on, and I'll plug this thing in and get everything all set up, and I'll be right back. I have the signal tracer plugged into my isolated AC supply, and I'm ready to try this thing out. So, I'll turn the thing on, and we'll see what happens. I'll just take a peek around the back and see if the rectifier tube is lighting up, and it is. That's a good sign. And I see the I-tube is coming on. Wow, that's nice and bright. In fact, that's extremely bright. So that just further confirms that this thing has low time on it. So when these things are left on for days and days and days at a time, these I-tubes tend to get weak pretty quick. So this looks like a brand new I-tube. Even in the camera with all that light shining on it, you can still see the green. I'll turn the light off here and see how bright that is. It's even shining some green onto the mat here. So incredibly bright tube. So let's check out the functions here. I'll turn the gain up a little bit, see how this works. And that sounds ugly. So we'll have to look into that, see why it's doing that. So it has lots of gain. So right now we're on the low gain side. So basically the grid of the high gain stage is grounded out. And I can also hear a little bit of crackling and hissing in there, so it sounds like there might be a noisy component in here. Yeah, I can hear it changing pitch a little bit there. So I'll have to look into that as well. I don't know if you can hear that in the microphone, if you can hear that the pitch changing a little bit there. Quite a bit of hiss there. There you go. Picked up a little bit. So, this is what this thing is designed to look for in other pieces of equipment. So if this thing is creating its own noise, it would be very hard to track down noise in other pieces of equipment. So that definitely has to go. You gotta find out where that noise is coming from. So what I'll do is I'll turn the gain down here and I'll just try the low gain side. So I'll just poke this capacitor in there. So basically I'm just, you know, coupling the hum from my body into this thing here. And that's working no problems. So what I'll do is I'll turn on the high gain side. Since this is high gain, I'll turn that down. And we'll try this side out. And that's very sensitive. So no problems with that. So I'll turn that off again. Just click this over to noise. I hope this is as apparent in the microphone as it is here. You can really hear it changing pitch. Really hear it starting to crackle there. So this is kind of an intermittent-y hiss kind of thing going on. Seems to do the same in the noise as in the tracer mode. So we'll have to look for those two things. We'll have to find out why this thing is sounding so grungy at the bottom end here. And we have to look for that hiss. We'll test the watt meter in the end. I'm not really too concerned about that right now. That's a very, very simple section here, and we'll see how accurate that is and check out exactly how well that works. See if it lines up to what it says on the face here. So that's what we'll do next. We'll check this out first. We'll look at this control right here. Before we start troubleshooting the signal tracer, let's take a look at the schematic and get an idea of what Heathkit was thinking when they put this thing together. So we'll start with a 12C8 tube here. This tube is the highest gain stage in this signal tracer, and they've got the input or the grid attached to a jack called the RF input. Now really, this isn't an RF input, it's an audio input. They've designed this jack to be hooked up to a demodulator probe, so they've just called it RF input. Now most signal tracing will only require you to use what they classify as the audio input, but if you're looking for an extremely low level signal, using this with audio is absolutely fine. They even have a blocking capacitor here as well. So this tube here, the 12C8 on the chassis, is this tube right here with a little top cap on the top. Alright, so this is the RF input jack here, which has been changed to a BNC. Alright, it goes through this capacitor here, the signal does, and runs right up through this wire right into the grid, which is this little top cap. Alright, we see the RF input jack, that blocking capacitor, right into the top cap, which is the grid. Now, they've put a little switch here on this grid line to keep this section quiet when you're using just this audio input. If you leave this switch open or in the on position, what'll happen is this section will induce hum into this 12H7, which is the second tube in the amplification chain here. All right, so that's this tube right here. All right, so the chain of amplification really from highest gain to audio drive is from this tube to this tube to this tube, and then this tube drives this audio transformer here, which in turn drives the speaker. So when you're not using this section, you want to have this switch in the off position, and that switch on the face of the unit is this high gain switch here, so you'd want to have that in the off position. So you can think of this as turning this jack off, and this is turning this jack on. Okay. So what we'll do is we'll check out the amplification chain here. I'll explain how the audio signal gets through. So just say we're going to feed a very low level audio signal into this grid here. All right, so we're going to use this really high gain stage. So the audio goes into the control grid, it gets amplified, we have a high level signal on the plate as well as DC voltage. So what we want is we want to get that high level signal into the grid of this 12SH7 tube without that DC voltage, and that's why we have a capacitor in between. So the capacitor lets the audio signal through but blocks the DC voltage on the plate of this tube. So the DC voltage comes directly right out of the high voltage power supply through a resistor and right into the plate. The DC voltage needs to be there because it's the supply voltage that makes the tube operate. So the capacitor blocks that voltage and passes only the amplified signal into the grid of the next stage. It gets amplified again in this tube. Again, we have a higher level signal on the plate line here, as well as DC voltage. This capacitor blocks the DC voltage and only lets the signal through into this tube. This tube here delivers the drive power to drive the speaker. So this tube here is what's driving the transformer, which is driving the speaker. And that's how this works. All right, so that's why it's so incredibly important to get rid of these old capacitors. I'll grab one of these old waxy caps here. That's why it's so important to get rid of these things. All right, what happens is these things leak electrically inside and they turn into resistors over time, and they pass the plate voltage through the capacitor onto the grid of the next stage, and it really starts to turn this tube on very, very hard, and that causes damage to the tube and burns out plate and cathode resistors and does all sorts of bad things. So that's why it's so incredibly important to get rid of those old paper capacitors. All right, so these are all the caps that have been changed, these smaller ones. When you see two lines like this, all right, that are straight, that means that it's a non-polarized capacitor. When you see a line that's straight and the bottom kind of has a bit of a hook to it, they haven't really illustrated that very well down here, but it kind of looks like this and like this. That's a polarized capacitor. So non-polarized and polarized. This side here is the negative side, and then this side is the positive side. They have a little bit of a curve to the bottom here, but you really got to look to see that. So these capacitors here, this one here, this one here, these two here, this one here, these are all, this one here, these are all the old paper capacitors that got replaced. In the electrolytics, the big cans that you see that I replaced on the bottom side are this one here, this one here, this one here, this one here, and this is that really small capacitor that's up on the cathode of the 12A6 here across that resistor. So that's the audio signal path here. So if we want to just use the audio input and not use the super high gain stage, you'll find that you probably won't use this very much unless you use the demodulator probe. So if we just want to feed our audio into the audio input jack, and that jack is this one that's right over here. All right, I've also changed this to a B and C. All right, so the signal goes through here into this three-position switch. It's a double three-position switch. They're not electrically connected together, but they are connected by the shaft. So the shaft is insulated, all right, so there's no connection between this line and this line here. This dotted line just shows that they are ganged together, all right? And that's this switch right here. So three positions. So this is the tracer mode. And that mode is where the arrow is pointing right now. So we've got tracer mode. This, if it points straight down, that would be the noise mode. And if it points over to this open circle, that's the watt meter mode. And this arrow over here would follow exactly. So if we point it down, these would both be pointing down. And if we move the switch one more, it would be pointing this way. All right. So if we feed an audio signal into here, we can see that the audio signal comes right down here, goes through a blocking capacitor, just in case you've got any DC voltage or anything on that. All right, goes right into this variable potentiometer here. That variable potentiometer is the gain control. Now that gain control is what was very noisy in this unit when we were moving it around. So this is one of the sections that we have to troubleshoot here. All right, so the signal comes right down here, goes into this arrow here. The arrow is the wiper inside the variable potentiometer. So that's the part that moves when you move the shaft on the front, and that moves up and down this resistor, okay? So the signal goes directly into the control grid, and it goes the exact same path that we had the first time I explained it here. So you can see that we've completely just skipped over this part. So again, when this input's used, this switch needs to be closed, or this will add hum into here. It'll act as a mixer, and it'll mix hum into here. So technically, if you wanted to mix two signals, you could feed a very low level signal into here, and you could feed a, you know, not such a low level signal into here, and it would actually mix it, and you'd have both of those signals mixed as it comes into this tube here. So that's how this works. So now if we move this over to the noise position, all right, which is now the arrow pointing straight down, what happens is we have a bit of voltage that they put out on this jack. So there's going to be high voltage on this audio input here. And the manual claims about 170 or something like that. I haven't measured it yet. We'll measure that in the end. And what happens is that by putting voltage on this audio input jack, is it allows us to test components to see if they're staticky or crackly, or, you know, if something's breaking down like a capacitor or a resistor inside. So how they've done that is they put DC voltage on this, and it also allows this section to listen while it's applying DC voltage. It's kind of is a neat little idea. So what's happening here is you can see, all right, we have a resistor here. We have somewhat of a voltage divider between this 100K resistor and this 470K resistor. If this 470K resistor opened, this voltage would definitely go high. All right, so definitely, you know, important to check those two. So what happens is if we follow this line all the way back, we can see that it goes right down into the power supply, and it says 229 volts here, okay? All right, or that could be 225. It's pretty small from up here. So what happens is the voltage comes here, goes through here, up here, and then we get voltage applied to this jack. Now that voltage doesn't get into the grid of this tube because we have another blocking capacitor here. If that voltage went directly into the grid of the tube, this tube would not operate correctly. So that allows us, again, to put voltage on here and listen at the same time. Kind of a neat idea. All right. So, and then this side here, it connects to the grid over here, All right, you can see that they're both connected in the tracer mode and in the noise mode. They're both connected to the same thing. So when you move this over, it's connected to the same spot. What they've done is they're picking the audio signal off of the control grid here of the 12A6 and feeding that into the grid of the 1629, and that causes that eye tube to deflect or to, you know, causes the shadow angle to change within this 1629. So now if we move this selector switch right over here to the last position, which is the wattmeter mode, that allows us to use this wattmeter section here, all right? So the audio input is then open. You can see that it goes to nothing. This section here, you can see, will be over here. That'll connect the grid of the 1629 to A. So A connects to A down here. You can picture that as a line connecting over here. And it connects us to this little transformer here. Now this is an ingenious little system and works quite well. So what I'll do is I'll just show you the transformer on the chassis here. So this transformer here, all right, is this transformer right here. Now you can see they've got one line. When you plug this signal tracer into the wall, one of the lines goes directly right through this transformer's primary, and the load that you're going to plug into the front face of the signal tracer is in series with this winding and just connects back to the line again. So what they're doing is when you plug a device into this little outlet, and that's this outlet right here on the face, all right, when you plug a device into this outlet, this is this variable potentiometer here. So keep that in mind, that's this one right here. All right. So when you plug a device into this outlet here, this is a relatively low impedance winding right here. So this is going to have a pretty thick winding on one side, just because, you know, if you plug a 500 watt device into here, it's, you know, there's going to be quite a bit of draw through this small winding here. So what happens is the more load you put on this, obviously the more current is across this winding here. All right, and of course we get our transformer action happening. There's no connection between this side and this side. There's isolation there. So we get voltage on this side here. All right. So what's going to happen is it's going to take what's on this side here, it's going to go down this line here, which is the wiper of that variable potentiometer, and it's going into this rectifier. So we have these two diode plates tied together. So these diode plates here are using this common cathode. This cathode is used for the amplifier, and it's also used for the rectification here. So we get direct current happening on this side. So we'll get direct current on this leg here. So by moving this variable potentiometer around allows us to, they've calibrated this with this scale on the face here. It's this little scale here they've written in all the wattages. All right. So they've calibrated that so that when this eye tube, when you change the deflection in this eye tube here so that basically it's just starting to open, it'll correspond with a wattage reading on the face as you're moving that. So as you're moving this, of course, it's calibrating everything. All right, and A is tied to A. It's changing the DC level at this point here. All right, and that DC level is applied directly to the grid of the 1629. And the 1629 tube is that indicator tube. So the grid is the controlling piece inside this tube. That's what controls the shadow angle inside the 1629. And that's really how this works. So kind of an ingenious little system here. So of course the accuracy of this is going to really depend on this 1 meg resistor and this 2.2 meg resistor. So you want to make sure that these are very close. Of course this 1 meg resistor is involved in this as well. So these were those rough looking, kind of hot doggy style looking resistors. They're rough. They're not the Allen Bradley style. So you definitely want to check these if your watt meter is reading way off. And in the end, we'll check out how accurate this watt meter is. I'll plug a couple of different loads in there and I'll show you exactly how to use the watt meter on this signal tracer here. So now the 12C8 tube is a little bit of a bizarre tube, and so is the 12SH7. Now, Heathkit used a bunch of really just odd tubes. The 12C8 tube is electrically identical to a 6B8, except the heater voltage is 12 volts for this tube. A 6B8 is 6 volts, so if you wanted to sub this tube, if you couldn't get a 12C8, a 6B8 would sub, but you need to amend the heater voltage. You can't just plug it directly in or you cause damage to that tube. The 12SH7 is electrically identical to the 6SH7, except the 12SH7 has a 12 volt heater in it. Again, Again, data sheets for these tubes are a little bit hard to find. If you got an old tube data book, you might be able to find one relatively easy, but they're not as easy as other tubes to find. Now, something that's really odd about the 12SH7 tube here, they're using this as an audio amplifier, right? You know, they're using this as an audio amp. So if we look at the data sheet here for a 12SH7 tube, we can see here it says the 6SH7, which is a 12SH7, it's electrically identical and it's even stated in all of the manuals, is not recommended for use as a high gain audio amplifier because its undesirable hum may be encountered. So maybe Heathkit had a whole bunch of these tubes kicking around and they just wanted to use them. Maybe they got a discounted purchase or something on a whole lot of the 12C8s and the 12SH7s. They're not a very common tube, so they may have bought up a whole bunch of these things. So I noticed that they've got a winding for 6 volts here. It's a 6X5, and this winding here they're using for 6 volts. So everything else here is running at 12 volts. So the heaters in this tube, this tube, this tube, and this tube are all at 12 volts. Now, they may have done this for a couple of reasons, because they're using a 1629 I tube. The heater voltage in a 1629 is a 12 volt heater again. So maybe they wanted to use this tube, so they just tailored the rest of the chain to use these tubes. I really don't know their thought there, why they've done that. Now, when they're drawing these tubes, they're not including the suppressor grid, and that creates a lot of confusion among people that are looking at these schematics, because they're drawing these as tetrodes, but really this is a pentode, right? And so on and so forth. Now, we can check that out by using the numbering system that's labeled on the sheet here. It says 12C8, so we know that the heater voltage is 12 volts. It's actually 12.6, all right, but they're not going to put 12.6 C8, right? So it's 12. C is the factory designation letter that allows us to tell this tube apart from all the rest of them. It just basically gives this tube its own identity. The number 8 is the amount of useful elements inside of this tube. So now, this tube here should have 8 useful elements. Now, I don't mean parts that glow, I just mean parts that are useful inside. So if we count, the heater is 1, cathode is 2, control grid is 3, screen grid is 4, plate is 5, this diode plate is 6, and this diode plate is 7, we have no other element. What's missing? The suppressor grid. So we can tell that they haven't drawn in one grid just by the numbering system. They haven't drawn in the grid here or the grid here as well. Now, again, they claim that, you know, sometimes that lessens confusion by keeping one grid out of there. And sometimes they just don't illustrate or draw the grid because it has just an internal connection, and they figure that it's, you know, doesn't need to be drawn in. But I find with a lot of people, they say, how come this is a pentode, but yet it's drawn as a tetrode? So that's the reason that they do that. Now, again, this here is a pentode with 2 diode plates in it, so it's kind of a special tube. Again, the 6B8 is electrically identical to this tube, just a different heater voltage. And this tube here is a 6SH7 with a different heater voltage. This is a 12SH7 tube, this one right here. And if you wanted to find one that's more common, you could have used that tube. All right. The 6X5 is just a rectifier tube. It's taking the high voltage off of this transformer. Alright, so the high voltage goes into these plates here. We have rectification happening and we have DC down here. Alright, so direct current is available here, and we have resistors going down, isolating each stage, and we're putting capacitors here so that, you know, we don't get, you know, this stage is seeing each other, and of course this adds more filtering as we go down here. So we're getting filtering as we go down. Of course, the more resistors we have, the more voltage drop we have as we go down, 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 down. And as you can see here, through the resistors here, we have, you know, roughly, you know, up to 35 volts at the plate here. And then, of course, this is tapped at a higher spot, so we have roughly 90 volts or so here. And the power amplifier tube here, which drives the transformer, has got the highest voltage on the plate because it has this transformer here. Now, the reason that they have an audio transformer, you'll notice in a lot of solid state gear that they don't have audio transformers connected to, you know, any of the transistors or FETs or anything like that. And that's because, you know, they can drive low impedance loads. So a tube isn't very good at driving a low impedance load like a speaker, which is say 3 or 4 ohms. So you need to transform the impedance on this side to the impedance on this side, hence transformer. All right, let's do some troubleshooting together. So the first thing we're going to go after is that staticky crackly noise when I moved this potentiometer around the gain control. It was really rough at one end here. So the first thing we want to do is, the simplest thing, is check to make sure that this variable potentiometer is working. So it was crackly and rough at this end, so basically when this was turned right down to nothing. So this end just ties to the chassis. So what I'm going to do is take my voltmeter probe here. I'll turn this on to ohms because we're going to measure resistance. I'll take my negative probe here. I've got an alligator clip on it, and I'll just clip this to the chassis like that. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the positive probe of my ohm meter and attach it to the wiper inside this variable potentiometer. So I'll grab my little clip over here. It's a nice little place to store it. Never seems to go missing there, so things magically go missing on this bench all the time. It's like some black hole around here or something. All right, so now I've got this attached here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to slowly raise this potentiometer. Now, you're going to see some pretty quick jumps in resistance here, and that's just due to the fact that this is a 1 meg ohm potentiometer, and it has very little area to go from pretty much a dead short all the way up to 1 meg at the other end. Really, what we're concerned with, the way that this thing acted, is if there's any breaks in that carbon track. So we'll find that out as we move the wiper. So I'll just start slowly moving this up. So it doesn't appear to be any breaks. I'll move this back down. So I'm ever so slightly moving this thing. As we get closer to the zero mark, it really moves fast. So I'm just touching this right now. See if I can bring this down slow enough to make it measure all the way down. Probably not. Yeah, so there we go. Takes a bit of a jump right at the bottom here. So it doesn't look like there's any breaks, and that's from that end to the complete opposite end. We'll just check the entire carbon track by going over here. Yeah, no problems with that. So there are no breaks in the carbon track. And the way that this thing was acting when we turned this down, it completely got silent. And then as we moved it up, it would crackle and it would come to life. So this leads me to believe that the problem is most likely not in this variable potentiometer. So what I'm going to do to check this out is I'm going to just tack in another variable potentiometer, that's 1 megohm, just across this terminal here, all right, and this terminal here. And what I'll do is I'll bring the new one down and we'll see if we can mimic the same crackling noise. So I'll turn this up about halfway to get it above the area on this potentiometer here. So I'll turn this up to about half. All right, this is still at the other end here. So turn it up to about half. All right, it's about, from what I can feel here, it feels like it's about halfway up. All right, and then I'm going to tack just another potentiometer across here, and I'm going to bring that potentiometer down to zero resistance and see if we get the same effect or the same noise out of this. So I'll do that right now, and I'll be right back. I have the test VR soldered into place, and I have this little green alligator clip here clipped to the case of the VR just to keep noise off the case. So what I'm going to do is turn on my isolated supply, and we'll let the tubes warm up in the signal tracer here for just a moment. So if I move this VR and it mimics the same noises that this one did, we can tell that this VR is okay. So in just a moment here, the tube should be warmed up. And that should be enough to make some noise. All right, so what I'm going to do is move this. This is still at halfway up, so it's pointing at about 50. So what I'll do is I'll move this. So right there, that tells us that this VR is okay. So if I turn this one up, and I turn this one down, this one should do the same thing that this one did, like it did in the beginning. So move that up, and we'll do this one again. So now that we know that this VR is okay, we have to look elsewhere in the circuit to find an issue. So what I'm going to do now is I'll just desolder this, get everything all hooked up normal again, and we'll start searching in the rest of the circuit. So the next thing we want to do is find out what's actually going on in the circuit. Why is it crackly when we move this around? So what I'm going to do is grab my clip here and put my clip back on my voltmeter probe, and we're going to take a look at the grid voltage as I move this variable potentiometer around, the gain control. So keep an eye on the meter here. So you can see me moving it up and moving it down again. So what's happening is they're bringing the grid voltage right down to 0 volts. All right, they're bringing it right down to ground. All right, so now let's take a look at the plate voltage. All right, so this is the plate voltage here. With the VR rate down, it's at 51 volts. Okay, so here it says 90 volts right there on the schematic. So the plate voltage is supposed to be. So what I'll do is I'll turn up the VR here. And that's full volume or full gain. And this is going right back down, bringing the grid to ground. So now you can see the voltage drop as we bring the control grid voltage towards ground. And as we bring that wiper away from ground, you can see how the voltage is rising up. So what's happening in this situation here, when the potentiometer's wiper is at ground and it's bringing that grid to zero, it's bringing the tube, the actual biasing of the tube, more positive, and it's causing the tube to draw heavy current. So right now, the tube is drawing current and it's pulling down the plate voltage, because right now, we're measuring at this point right here. So as I advance this towards the top end of the VR here, all right, it's bringing the grid further away from ground, and you'll see this voltage rise because the tube is establishing bias at this point. Now, what they've done here is kind of a very interesting system, and I can see where they've probably caught within their design. In order to create a high gain amplifier, you don't want to lift the cathodes off of the chassis. If you do, you risk the chance of modulating the cathode with the AC that's present in the filament, because that filament is in that cathode sleeve. So what they want to do is tie that cathode directly to ground and keep that as tight to ground as possible so that you don't get any sort of cathode modulation going on. At the same point, the way they've got this variable potentiometer wired up here, they're varying the bias that's on pin 4 here. So by varying the bias, they're causing this tube to draw heavy current at the lowest volume, and then when you bring the potentiometer right up to the top, so maximum volume, this thing is creating its own bias through a thing called grid leak. All right, so really what's happening in a grid leak situation is, because this cathode is not lifted above ground with a resistor, the cathode goes directly to ground, the electrons that are flying off this cathode are hitting the control grid, and that is actually putting a negative voltage on that grid. All right, that's why when we turn this VR up, we can see a negative voltage happen here. So what I'll do is I'll tie this back over here again. And as I raise the volume, you'll see a negative voltage appear here. So that's at full volume. I can just shut the speaker off. That's at full volume right there. All right, so we can see we have negative 0.6 of a volt, whereas when I bring this down to ground, we're right at ground, or very, very close to, anyways. So you can see what's going on here. They're moving the bias around with this VR, and that's the reason that this tube is getting crackly, because as we get the VR very close to the ground end here, this tube is starting to turn on very hard. All right, and we're also taking this voltage on the grid and abruptly grounding it out here. So any kind of noise in this VR here is going to be very apparent as we ground the voltage out on that grid. Now, the voltage on this grid is very, very minute, because there's just electrons colliding with this grid in here as the electrons are flying from the cathode to the plate. So that's the issue. So this should also be causing this thing to pull heavy screen current at the same time here. So the screen is rated at 25 volts. So let's just check the screen voltage while we're here. So this is the screen right here, 2.2 meg resistor there. So we're supposed to be at 25 volts on the screen, and we've got 4 volts on the screen. All right, so it's pulling heavy current on the screen as well. So I'll raise the gain or the volume here again, and we'll see that change. See, up to 21 volts. As we come down here, we can see that it's pulling screen current. So the whole idea is to stop it from doing this, and that's a very simple thing to do. Now, on the cheap, you could get by with just basically moving this wiper connection to the top of the VR and the top of the VR to the grid, if you don't want to add any more parts. But since they're running this thing in a grid leak, I can kind of critique this a little bit and bring this a little bit into, a little better operating area. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do a modification. So I'm going to isolate this with another capacitor. I'm going to put another capacitor in here so that when I bring this wiper down to zero, it's not going to drag the grid down to zero anymore, right? Because the capacitor will block the DC. And then what I'm going to do is critique a resistor from here to ground that will allow this tube to be biased properly, and that should fix the situation. So what I'm going to do is put that capacitor in here, and I'll play with a grid leak resistor. So the grid leak resistor is usually between 1 mega ohm and about 10 mega ohms. So that's the area that I'm going to be playing in. So I imagine I'll probably be about halfway somewhere. So what I'm going to do is I'll move around these values here, and when I have something to report, I'll be back. The modification is complete, and it really is quite a simple modification. So all I did was remove this wire from the grid pin. This is the wire that runs up to the wiper on the VR here. I put a capacitor in series with that wire to the grid pin, and I installed a 5.6 meg resistor from the grid pin to ground, and that really is it. So in order to keep the job looking clean, what I did is I removed a few components off of this eyelet in the bottom of the tube socket here, and I soldered in another ceramic standoff, and I'm just using that as a tie point to support this end of the capacitor and wire. And the components that I moved was this capacitor here, and there was a 470K resistor that I attached to a different ground. And that pretty much is all there's to it. So let's take a listen and see how that works. So I'll move the gain control around. No problems whatsoever. We can hear our second troubleshooting procedure lurking in here, kind of crackling and popping there. So that'll be the second thing that we troubleshoot. But as you can hear, that really loud, obnoxious pop and crackling noise right down here at the bottom is completely gone. And that's what we wanted to accomplish. So, unfortunately, Heathkit has a little bit of a design flaw here. So in order to correct that design flaw, all you do is you put that capacitor in line with the wiper to the grid on the schematic here, and you put a 5.6 meg resistor from the grid to ground. And that's it. And that'll get rid of that problem altogether. So we'll take a look at the result. What I'll do is I'll attach this to the plate resistor here. So this is on the plate side. Now, if you remember, when we moved this variable potentiometer around, the plate voltage moved a lot because, of course, it was changing the bias. You'll see now when I move this up, everything is nice and stable. Nothing's moving around. And the same will be for the screen grid. The screen grid is at 26 volts. No problems. That's much closer to the values we have on the schematic. 25 volts for the screen, 26 volts, and 90 volts for the plate. So no issues whatsoever. We had 96, I believe that was. Very, very close. Yeah, 96 volts. No problems whatsoever. So that's working really good. So now what we're going to do is take a look at the grid voltage. So the reason it's humming is because of this long lead. I'll just shut the speaker off. So there we go. We have minus 0.6 of a volt. And it's working really good. And when I move this around, as you see, no movement in the grid voltage whatsoever. So now the grid leak system is working effectively. So next what I'm going to do is I'm going to get my little oscilloscope here and we'll take a look at the signal purity coming out of this thing. I have my signal generator in my small oscilloscope hooked up to the signal tracer now. So how I've got these pieces of gear hooked up, my signal generator is feeding a signal into the audio input here, and my oscilloscope is picking the signal off the control grid or pin 5 of the 12A6. So what we'll do is we'll take a listen and take a look at the signal here. Looks great, no problems. As you can see, that's nice and smooth, nice fluid control. No popping or crackling or anything like that. Works very, very well. So I'm very happy with the result. So now we're on to troubleshooting the second problem, which is that crackling. For those of you that were watching the battery video that I did with this 224 oscilloscope, there's a couple of really common questions that I didn't answer in that video. One of them was how long the battery pack lasts. The battery pack in this lasts 8.5 hours of continual use. So if I turn this thing on and walk away, it'll still be running at 8 hours. 8.5 might actually be just a little bit conservative because I was using this for shots in the video without recharging it throughout the whole thing. So to be conservative, I'll say comfortably 8.5 hours that this will last on one charge. The battery pack in the scope charges off of the wall wart that plugs into the backside of this here. So the scope itself has its own charging circuit inside. So all in all, I'm really happy with the way that that battery pack turned out and the way that the scope works. Okay, we're ready to get started on our second troubleshooting adventure in this little signal tracer. So if you recall earlier, when I turn the gain control up, there's kind of a staticky hissing popping noise that's randomly there, you know, when the gain control is pretty high. We need to get rid of that because, you know, if we're searching for noise in another device, we won't know which device is making the noise. Now that's kind of a random hissing and popping noise on top of that steady static noise that's already there. So hopefully when we find the problem, it'll also lower that kind of steady static noise as well. So I'll turn the gain control up and we'll take a listen. And hopefully it'll act up a little bit. It is right now, I can hear it. Sometimes it gets really crazy, other times it kind of just settles like this, but it's doing it right now. You can hear it pick up a little bit there. So that's a really noisy circuit. So we definitely want to locate this and get rid of that completely. And again, hopefully that'll also knock down that steady hissing noise that's in there as well. So it's kind of subtle right now. And of course that, you know, makes the troubleshooting procedure a little bit tougher. If it was really loud all the time, it'd be relatively easy to find in this circuit. But hey, if it's easy to find, what's the fun in that? This allows us to troubleshoot for a little while here. Okay, so we already know quite a bit by just turning this control up and down. When we turn the gain control up, we hear a lot of noise. When we turn it down, it pretty much goes silent. Right now, it's pretty much dead silent. So that tells us that most likely the noise is before this tube. All right, so it's probably not after this circuit here. It's probably before and in this line here somewhere. All right, if this tube was noisy itself, we'd still hear that noise because even though we turn the, you know, the control grid down, right, and this is bringing this, the AC level or the, you know, the signal level close to ground, All right. It still could make noise, like it can generate its own noise. So if it was like, say, a noisy grid structure in there, or there was internal arcing, it would still amplify that noise and we would still hear it. So it's a pretty good indication that most likely the problem is on this side of the potentiometer or up into this circuitry up in here. We can say comfortably the 1629 tube is out of the picture because it ties in at the control grid of the 12A6, all right, way over here. And we can pretty much, you know, take the power supply out of the equation as well, because we have all brand new filters here, and you know, there's enough filtering here that no hissing would be able to get out of this circuit. So really, we're focusing on this area right here. So we'll start with the 12C8 tube, because that's right in the front here, and this is the highest gain stage here. Now, even though we ground out the control grid of this tube is still active, it's still on. All we're doing is pretty much bringing any signal level on the grid to ground. So what we want to do is eliminate this tube out of the equation. So if this tube is part of the problem, we want to, you know, work our way down. Now, if we look at the power supply here, we see there's 200 volts here, runs up to a 470 k ohm resistor, and then right onto the plate of the 12C8 tube. So 470 k ohms is such a high resistance value that we can just take a jumper clip from the chassis and just ground out the plate circuit. This resistor here won't even get mildly warm at that. All right, so that's what we're going to do first. Now, keep in mind that whenever you're working on a circuit like this and you're, you know, moving an alligator clip in and out of circuit, it is dangerous, especially if you clip it to the wrong area. And right, you're using your hands close to this. So if you're following along, you're definitely doing so at your own risk. You want to take care when you're doing this. If you clip that alligator clip on the wrong side of this resistor, you're going to get a mighty big spark. Okay, so what I'll do is I'll grab an alligator clip here. This one right here. All right, so I'll just clip this onto the chassis, like so. All right, so this is grounded out and this is insulated here. So what we want to do is locate pin 3 of the 12C8. So what we do is we find the index pin, which is that center locking pin, and we count clockwise from that index pin around. And we're also looking for a 470 k ohm resistor and a 0.005 capacitor. So we've replaced all the capacitors, so we already know that this is the 0.005 capacitor here, and if we follow that lead, it goes right into the 470 k ohm resistor. So 3 from the index pin. The index pin is kind of, you know, disguised under this capacitor here, but it goes 1, 2, and 3. This is pin 3 right here. So what I'll do is I'll turn up the gain control. You can hear it's kind of picking up right now. And what I'm going to do is ground out pin 3, and we'll see if we have any change. All right, so it'll get a little bit quieter, but if the static is in there, we'll still hear the static. So here we go. And it's still there. I don't know if you can hear that. So what I'm going to do is lift the chassis up to the microphone here, and hopefully you'll hear it. So now when I'm grabbing this chassis, I'm grabbing the filter capacitor, and I'm also grabbing an area of the chassis that is grounded, and I'm making sure that my hands are not coming towards anything that's live, because there's a lot of high voltage in this chassis. If I was to hold this capacitor and come across something in here, I would get the shock of my life. So I don't want to take that chance. So remember, if you're following along, you're doing so at your own risk. Okay? So I'm grabbing the can, and there's nothing in this area of the chassis. So I'm going to pick this up and lift this up like this, and hopefully you can hear the static noise in there. You hear it? It's still randomly doing it. There's a couple good little spikes right there. Okay, so I'll just put this back down again. Right, so we know that it's still doing it. So we know that we've grounded this signal path out right here completely. So chances are it's going to be within this area right here. Now, we've replaced all these capacitors here. So there's probably a pretty good chance that it's here, here, or here, or somewhere in this small area. So just to eliminate this 12SH7 out of the equation, I'm going to do the same thing to it. I'm going to ground out pin 8. Now we have a very high value resistor here, or high resistance resistor. It's 390 k ohms. And it is to a, you know, a slightly higher voltage portion of the power supply, but this resistor, if I ground out pin 8, will only get mildly warm, okay? Now, we definitely cannot do that to the 12A6. If we grounded out the plate on the 12A6, we would burn this transformer right out. And if we also did it to the screen grid as well, we would still burn this transformer right out. So you can definitely not do anything like that to a power amplifier stage. All right, as again, this resistance value is so high that grounding it out would be absolutely fine. In other amplifier circuits, these resistance values vary a lot. So if this was like a 47 k ohm resistor or something like that, I would definitely not ground this out here. Or if this was a lower value resistor, I wouldn't do that as well. Okay, so it really depends on the circuit. In this circuit, it's okay for me to ground out this without burning out that resistor. All right, so I'll remove this from here. Okay, so that tube is active again. Even though that this switch is closed, you can still see how much noise that adds into the circuit. So we're going to look for pin 8 of the 12SH7. This is a 12SH7. Just turn this down for a moment. So there's the index pin right there. I don't know if you can see that. The index pin is right here. This is the lock. And a lot of the times the pin numbers are even marked right on the base. So this is pin 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and pin 8. And we can see that that 390 k ohm resistor is right here. So that's definitely where we're going to clip to ground. Okay, so I'll clip this to ground and we'll see what happens. Now, as you can hear, gain right up to maximum. It's dead silent. No problems there whatsoever. So that definitely tells us at this point that the problem is somewhere within this small area right here. So I'll just remove this. So now, a part that would most likely create a lot of noise is this voltage divider right here, because you can see it's tied into the circuit all the time. And, you know, we have, you know, a pretty high voltage at this point, you know, 220 some odd volts is at this end of the resistor. We have a voltage divider through this 100K resistor through this 470K resistor to ground. And then it's also going into the circuit. So this actually is acting as its own noise circuit as well. If any of these start crackling or getting noisy, it's going to feed that directly right into the grid of this 12SH7 through this variable potentiometer. Now we know that we can change the level of the static and everything by moving this along. So we're moving this wiper down to the ground, it gets quiet, and when we move it to the top, it gets noisy. So there's a very good chance that one of these resistors in the divider is noisy, and we'll check that out right now. Now, a lot of the times we can check that out by just bumping these resistors. They'll be noisy if there's a fracture inside the resistor, or, you know, if one of the leads, you know, that goes into the resistor has lost contact with the carbon inside, it'll get noisy when we push on it. So that'll be our first test. And if we can't make it do anything by doing that, what we're going to do is put a soldering iron under it and just gently heat it and see if, you know, heating it is going to make any difference. So I already moved this 470K resistor's ground, so I know where these two components are already. The 470K resistor's down here, and this is the 100K resistor right here. So what I'm going to do is turn up the gain, and I'll tap the resistor and move it around and see what happens. So here we go. I'll just get this alligator clip off the chassis. So here we go. Yeah, we can tell that it's moving that static noise around for sure. So I'll just push on it. Wow, that's noisy. So I'll move the 470 k ohm resistor around. And we can pretty much say that's quiet. So that's a pretty solid yes, that this is the problem right here. So chances are what's happening in here is one of the leads that's gone into this Allen-Bradley style resistor inside the resistor is probably disconnected or just making an intermittent contact to, you know, the carbon element inside here. Or, you know, there's a fracture inside or something like that that's making this, you know, really, really pretty profound staticky noise. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to remove this resistor and replace it, and we'll see what that does to our static level. Now, there's many ways of locating this kind of stuff. Again, you can heat it with a soldering iron. A lot of the times that will change it because it expands the parts inside, right? And then the static level will change. Or just pushing on the body itself will, you know, be a pretty good indication. Now, this can also be very tricky because if you have other components that are older that are attached to this, moving this around will also move them around. Now, these are all new capacitors, so I'm not really worried about that. I'm pretty sure that this is, you know, the problem. We pushed on this resistor over here, and that would flex the lead to this capacitor here, and if there was any noise, it would have happened there. And this is just a solid connection in here to a terminal tie strip, so it's pretty, you know, hands down that this here is the problem. So what I'm going to do is replace this component here, and we'll try it out again and see if that eliminates the issue. The resistor is installed right here. So I'll turn the gain up full and let's take a listen. That's at full gain. Wow, what a difference. So there is a little bit of hum in the circuit, and that's due to a few things. The first thing is there's no case around this, so there's no shielding around it right now. And this 12C8 tube does introduce just a little bit of hum into the circuit, even though it's in the off position or the grid is grounded. So if you wanted to make this thing just a little bit quieter, you could remove the 12C8, but then you could only use the audio jack that would render the RF input jack not usable. For myself, I'm really not too concerned about that slight hum in there. This is a piece of test gear, and if I want to use a demodulator probe or something with this, it's ready to go. Again, the hum really doesn't bother me all that much. So now that we have this little resistor out of circuit, this is the bad resistor, let's see how the noise testing circuit in this thing works. So what I'll do is I'll hook a probe up to this thing here, and I'll hook this resistor in line, and I'll be right back. Okay, I've got the noisy resistor across my probe here. All right, so that's the resistor that I removed from the underside. And I have it in tracer mode, so there's no voltage across this right now in tracer mode. So what I'm going to do is turn this up, and I'm going to click it into the noise mode, and we'll see if this gets very noisy. That little bit of hum that you're hearing is just because there's an exposed end. There's a lot of exposed area here, so really it's just a big hum antenna. This is very sensitive. So let's click it to noise and take a listen. That's definitely a noisy part. That works very, very well. So I'll click it back to tracer mode. I'll turn the gain down. All right, and I'm just going to change out this resistor. I'll put in a 100K resistor. That's exactly the same one that I put in on the underside here. All right, so this is a newer 100K resistor. So I'll turn the gain up, put it back to noise mode again. Dead quiet. No problems whatsoever, aside from that hum, of course, because this is open up here. So I'll put it back to tracer mode, and I'll put the noisy resistor back in for one more example here. Okay, noisy resistor back in again. All right, so here we go, gain up and to noise. So definitely a useful function. So again, when using the signal tracer in the noise position here, you want to make sure that you don't come across the probes. Again, this one here measured at 200 volts across the probe here. All right, so now I have a load across this right now is 100k ohms, and I'm not sure how much that's going to pull this down. Probably pull it down a little bit, but still, you know, 200 volts is quite a bit of voltage. So that's mentioned in the manual as well. So if you have a copy of the manual, you'll be able to see that. So this resistor is definitely faulty. Here's a quick example of the way the wattmeter works. So I have the exposure in my camera turned right down just because this green eye is so bright. So I've got a 116 watt load hooked up to the line cord here. It's a very, very large resistor sitting on another bench. So what we do is we turn this to the wattmeter position here, and we advance this control just until the eye opens. Okay, so just until it opens. Right there. So let's take a look and see what we've got. There we go. Right on 115 watts. Pretty close. Not too bad. So what I'm going to do now, you can see that if you keep going, it'll just keep opening. Right? So you want to do it just until it opens, right there. And it's very accurate. Right on 115 watts. The resistor is 116 watts. The next jump is 130, so I'd say this is doing very, very well. So I'll look for another load here, something a little bit lower, and we'll try it again. I have a 60 watt light bulb hooked up to the wattmeter load outlet. It's one of these swirly filament type bulbs, the same one that I'm using in my variac and isolation supply as current limiting. So let's see what they read. So again, we want to just open the deflection here until the line's about even. So right about there. A little more right about there. What are we at? A little over 55 watts. It says about maybe 56, 57 watts. Sometimes these light bulbs are a little bit shy as well. So not bad. It's working quite well. So quite a useful little feature to check the draw on devices up to about 500 watts. As I mentioned in some earlier videos, I'm fixing up this older test gear so I can show you guys how to fix antique and modern equipment with this older test gear. This stuff goes around for pretty cheap. You can find this stuff at swap meets and online auctions and stuff like that for next to nothing, and it really is quite valid once it's restored. So on the left-hand side you see the oscilloscope, and on the right-hand side with a little eye glowing in the bottom is the signal tracer that we just did, and in the background with a little red light is a vacuum tube voltmeter. So the next thing on the list that I'm going to do is I'm going to work on an older signal generator and get that up and running. And when I have a whole test bench ready to go, I'll start a small series on repairing equipment with this older test gear. Thanks for stopping by the lab today. Hope you enjoyed this episode involving the signal tracer. If you did, you can let me know by giving me a big thumbs up and hang around. There'll be more episodes just like this in the near future involving solid state and vacuum tube electronics. So if you're into electronics, this is the place to be. I'll see you next time. Take care.